Il gas naturale, Noelì ci racconterà come in effetti, dietro le parole appunto e le spiegazioni che ci darà, tutta la grande balla del gas naturale come combustibile di transizione risulta assolutamente evidente dall'estensione degli investimenti fatti a livello globale, dalla costruzione di reti globali di trasmissione, di sfruttamento e di comunicazione connesse alle reti di gas naturale. Per recuperare tutta quella marea di investimenti, altro che transizione, ci vorranno decine e decine di anni e francamente sono almeno 30 anni che sentiamo parlare del gas naturale come combustibile di transizione. Quindi analizzare anche la struttura del sistema del gas naturale ci spiega come questo sia connesso a tematiche più generali di giustizia climatica ed ambientale ed ecologica, perché il gas naturale, come tante altre false soluzioni ai cambiamenti climatici, non fa altro che ritardare sempre di più il momento nel quale dobbiamo assolutamente decidere che l'unica strategia è quella di tenere i combustibili fossili sottosuolo. Quindi lascerei la parola a Noelì e ringraziandola per la pazienza.
Thank you. Hello, I'm going to speak in English. Hi everyone. My name is Noelì. Thank you for the presentation and for inviting me today. So I'm going to talk a bit about the work that we do with the Gastivist Network, and then I'm going to talk a bit about the types of repression and state violence that is experienced within the network that is fighting gas around the world. So we created the Gastivist Collective about 2 years ago, and it was exactly in reaction to what was explained. This idea that gas is still being sold as really this clean transition fuel, and even a lot of environmental NGOs are still considering it as a potential solution. And so we saw that more and more groups were starting to fight it, and we wanted to help coordinate all of these groups that were building the movement against gas. So we tried to work as much with people that are working at a very local level. So for example, the NoTap groups in Italy, people that are really fighting the infrastructure. We also try and connect with groups that fight the transport of gas, so gas being transported through land on pipelines, but also through LNG cargoes, so gas is liquefied, put on a cargo, sent through boats, and then regasified when it arrives, and it means that gas can come from all around the world. And we work with people that try and fight the system that is supporting the whole gas. So the banks, the private banks, the public banks that finance the gas system, and also obviously the companies that are profiting from this gas system. So our role is to connect different people that work together to share the information, to make sure that we're more than just the sum of our parts and that we're working effectively. This was mainly thought in the view of what is happening in Europe right now, where there's a real massive push for gas. There's loads of new infrastructure that is seen as strategic and that has a lot of support from the European Union. And so we saw this window of opportunity for us to stop a lot of big projects. And the more we started working on it, the more we realized that obviously this is not just limited to Europe. If there's more infrastructure being built in Europe, it means there's more extraction happening elsewhere. And so we're trying to connect more and more globally. So to give a bit of an example, because we are in Italy with the NoTap resistance, so we try and help people that are not in Italy understand how they can play a role, strategic role, in supporting the fight here. So for example, we talked a lot with groups in Switzerland where the TAP consortium is based and exists, and where they've started a small campaign against TAP in Switzerland. We've launched a campaign in London where the EBRD was discussing a potential loan for the TAP, which was approved this summer, but there's still an ongoing campaign over there. We're working in Belgium with a group that is campaigning against their mayor in Ghent, Daniel Termont, who is the chairman of Fluxys, which is one of the main companies behind TAP. So I think it's a good example to have to show how it's really a system that we're trying to fight. It's not just one battle in one place. We're trying to fight everything at the same time and to understand how it's not just a frontline community that can make a difference. It's a lot of people that have points of intervention to fight the system that is being imposed on us. And this works in the other way around. For example, we came to visit the NOTAP committee with an indigenous spokesperson from Mexico who is resisting a pipeline in her communities, which is constructed by an Italian company here. So also realizing that the NOTAP committee, for example, but other fights can play a role in supporting others. So to prepare a bit for this workshop, I tried to reach out to the groups that we work with to ask what kind of repression do they experience, what kind of state violence do they have to go through, and to see what were their responses and to bring it back to you. And so, not surprisingly, there's a lot about police violence, about criminalization that we've heard a lot already about, intimidation, threats, but there was also a lot about economic burden that is being put on them by the state. So really, not just seeing the repression as something physical, but also an institutional weapon that is being put on them. So I'm going to talk about both, but spend a bit more time on the economic weapon, because I find we've covered quite a bit already about the police violence and criminalization. So police violence, we've heard about it in Italy here, in Argentina yesterday. It happens again and again. There's nothing very surprising to add. Maybe just to say again that the repression is always seen much more extreme outside of Europe and North America. In the global South, it's always something that is not comparable, and just to keep this in mind. Increased criminalization, we've heard about it in the UK with the anti-fracking activists being arrested and sentenced to jail, but it's happening everywhere. What I also find interesting, and that's what some groups were reporting back to me, is that there's also more and more legal tools that are put in place to make it easier to criminalize activists. So for example, in Sweden there's an LNG terminal that is currently being built, and the construction site has now been put in a protected area legally. So it means that any action that might want to happen around the LNG terminal would make it very easy for the activists to be condemned to go to jail straight away. So it really raises the stakes of taking action, and it's a really strategic way for them to limit the resistance that's happening. Intimidation and threats to safety. The indigenous spokesperson who came from Mexico is obviously was sharing a lot about the real threat to her life that it is for her to be fighting the pipeline. And I think it's just important to remind, we've heard in Argentina also what is happening. I'm not going to go more in detail. The economic violence that is seen by a lot of groups as a weapon by the state to really repress the struggle, I think is important to talk about. And I think works quite well with what we've been talking about with pacification, this idea that it's a constant struggle and a constant war, and it's not just when there's one big action and police repression, it's constantly ways of making it hard for people to resist. So in terms of economic tools that are used, there's compensation, gas bills, and I'm going to talk a bit about ISDS. So in terms of compensation, for example, we've seen in Indonesia in 2006, there was a huge mudslide that was the consequence of gas extraction happening over there. 15 villages were swept away and hundreds of people were displaced. They are still all waiting on any compensation. Nothing has been received so far. However, the company that was behind the gas extraction and the mudslide has now received more permits to be able to continue exploring and extracting. So we see obviously this imbalance between local citizens compared to companies that are profiting. Another example on compensation, which I find really interesting, is in the Netherlands. Groningen is one of the biggest gas fields in Europe where gas is extracted. They've been doing it for decades, and it has led to a number of earthquakes happening over the years. And these earthquakes have damaged, they consider over 100,000 homes have been damaged by the earthquakes. And this makes it very hard for people in terms of their safety to just keep living in a home that is not safe. They've lost all the value of their home, so it's very difficult for them to be able to sell the home and move somewhere else. So they're stuck in this unsafe environment. There's been a huge amount of mental health issues arising from it. But in terms of compensation, what's been really smart from the companies behind it, Shell and Exxon together, is that they come to a small village and they tell to one person, we will compensate you fully, to another, we will compensate half, and to the third, we will not compensate at all. And so it's really a tool that has been useful to divide and try and really limit the coordinated resistance that can happen. And so, yeah, that's interesting tools, I think, to see as a weapon that is used against resistance. I wanted to talk a bit about the gas bills. So this idea that it can come all the way to how much you pay on your gas bill. And this is a way of also limiting the resistance, because it means the entire community, even if they're not resisting, are going to have to pay higher bills because of what is happening. So for example, in the USA, in the state of Vermont, there's a local group that has been resisting a gas pipeline. And they've just found out that the company building the pipeline has stood before the Department of Public Service to request that they be given the permission to recoup the costs of surveillance of activists by charging their customer higher rates of gas. So what is happening is that everyone in the community is going to have to pay higher bills for the gas because of the cost of surveying the resistance that is happening. I find it totally surreal, the local activists also, but it's a very interesting tool also to divide everyone in a community. It's really smart of them. Another example with the gas bills is in Spain. I don't know if you've heard about the Castor project. So Castor was an offshore gas platform and storage facility off the coast of Spain, and it's a very opaque case, and it's being worked on by a number of NGOs over there right now. But after a couple of years, once the project was finished, they decided to put it in a total hibernation state. So it's not being used at all, because there was earthquakes when they started using it, and also because there wasn't really a need for the project in the first place. But what happened is that the state had guaranteed the project, and so they had to indemnify the company with over 1.3 million euros. And this is now being put onto the gas bills of consumers everywhere in Spain. So we see again this idea of a company doesn't take a lot of risks, they are able to be indemnified, and then it's a local population that have to bear the literal cost, economic costs of these risks. And just to finish on the economic weapons, is also, we've just seen in Egypt a case of ISDS. So the Egyptian government has been condemned to pay 1.7 million euros to Naturgy and Eni for a lack of supply to an LNG terminal. So using these international trade agreements as a tool to be able to, for companies to be able to hold government accountable for not being able to supply what they said. And then obviously this cost is burdened onto local people through their gas bills or through cuts to the general budget of the state. To go back to just the general types of institutional weapons that are being used, one that came up, which I thought was really interesting and I wanted to share here, is the bureaucracy that people have to go through. I think it's never really understood as something difficult, but if you think of the amount of time and energy and capacity spent by local communities or by activists to have to file, to be able to get compensation, to have to do a legal procedure, any of this to support any, what we're seeing, for example, with the fracking activists in the UK, the amount of energy put in the support networks around it is huge. And I think it's also, in a way, a kind of weapon, a violent weapon that is used for, in an institutional way to really limit the way that we organize and that we resist. And that was really taught to me quite a lot in the Netherlands, where there's been all the earthquakes and communities are trying to get compensations, and that they're calling someone on the phone that is never the right person that has the power to do anything. They have to call someone else and fill in a file, and it just goes on and on for months. And it's just a very difficult, time-consuming thing. And I even see it in the way that, for example, we've recently received EU funding for the Gastivist Network. the amount of bureaucracy that we have to fill in to explain how we are spending the money means that actually one of the people that we work with is now only doing reporting on how we spend our money, so is no longer able to actually do the work. I think it's interesting ways of bureaucracy that they use to limit the way that we're able to fight this system. I think I will stop here. Thank you for listening.
Grazie davvero Noelì, perché ci hai dato anche una serie di strumenti per comprendere meglio qual è la cassetta degli attrezzi che viene utilizzata per controllare, reprimere o governare anche il dissenso sociale e ambientale. Particolarmente interessante credo che sia stato il punto nel quale ci hai raccontato come di fatto le imprese e gli stati utilizzino gli strumenti propri, diciamo, dell'economia capitalista o della finanza, ovvero sia ad esempio esternalizzare alcuni dei costi, le cosiddette externalities della sorveglianza su di noi nella bolletta diciamo del gas, o anche l'utilizzo di clausole di arbitrali di risoluzione delle controversie, le cosiddette investment to state dispute resolution, che sono una parte centrale della modalità con la quale la legge dei mercati di fatto prende il sopravvento rispetto ai diritti dei popoli. Ed è un punto interessante, ad esempio vi faccio un caso rapido e poi lascio la parola a Enzo Di Salvatore, perché di fatto abbiamo notato in questi giorni, ma anche nelle parole di quello che ci hanno raccontato Elena e Noelì, come esista una tensione continua tra legalità e illegalità, la trasformazione della legge e del diritto per poter svolgere attività che fino ad allora erano considerate illegali, che ora vengono legalizzate appunto per favorire l'accesso a risorse naturali e controllare, diciamo, il dissenso sociale, politico ed ecologico e ambientale. In Ecuador di recente, cioè da anni, si è sviluppata una causa contro la Chevron per quanto riguarda le ricadute tragiche, ricadute ambientali appunto delle attività estrattive nell'Amazzonia ecuadoriana. È stato un caso che è stato anche al centro di campagne internazionali che ha poi innescato tutta una serie di ricadute importanti, come ad esempio una campagna mondiale su un trattato vincolante per le imprese che è tuttora in corso e che si svolge anche all'interno del Consiglio ONU sui diritti umani. La causa, la Chevron, la perse, nel senso che qualche mese fa un tribunale legittimo dell'Ecuador condannò la Chevron a risarcire il danno per 500 milioni di dollari. Contemporaneamente Chevron ha utilizzato l'altra strategia, quella di andare a delle corti arbitrali internazionali dove chiaramente, avendo maggiori fondi a disposizione per il patrocinio legale, poteva avere maggiori possibilità di vincere. In effetti, dopo qualche mese, la causa l'ha vinta all'AIA, una corte arbitrale dell'AIA, che ha condannato in effetti il governo ecuadoriano a ripagare le spese legali, in quanto, secondo questa corte arbitrale, la causa per il risarcimento dei danni sarebbe stata vinta attraverso la corruzione dei testimoni da parte appunto del governo ecuadoriano. Questo per dire che esiste quindi una grande tensione tra cosa è legale e cosa è illegale, tra legalità e illegalità, che credo sia uno degli elementi sui quali dovremmo continuare a interrogarci anche quando cerchiamo di cogliere il nesso causale e funzionale tra estrattivismo, repressione e pacificazione,